The Lord be with you. Welcome to those of you who are gathered here in the sanctuary and to those of you who are worshiping with us online. If you are watching from home, I encourage you to download the bulletin from the homepage of our website so that you can participate fully in the service. Also, if you are new to Westminster, I hope you will fill out the online visitor form also on the homepage so that we can welcome you into our community of faith. The flowers for this, the 4th of July, are given by Susie Herlock to the glory of God and in loving memory of Fred Herlock Jr., as well as David John Fry, who served in the U.S. Marine Corps. The flowers are also given in honor of those who have served or who are currently serving to protect our country, both at home and abroad. We have a number of educational offerings for adults, all of which meet via Zoom. There are two Wednesday Bible studies, one at noon, the other at 6 o'clock p.m. Our Peace and Justice Work Group continues to host Thursday evening education events at 7 o'clock p.m., This week, the group will discuss the actions taken during the most recent session of the Delaware Legislature and the work that lies ahead. And starting this Wednesday, July 7th, Westminster member Bob Cox will begin a four-week series on early Christian writings that did not make it into the canon of Scripture. You can read more about all of these offerings on page 6 of the bulletin, and of course, new faces are always welcome at all of our adult education offerings. Children from pre-kindergarten through grade 6 are invited to participate in Vacation Bible School during the week of July 26th. This year's curriculum is Knights of North Castle, which will introduce children to Bible stories about the armor of God in their lives. You can read more about Vacation Bible School, including information on our COVID safety guidelines and how to register to join in the fun, on page 7 of the bulletin. Siblings in Christ, let us worship God. Praise the Lord, all nations. Extol our Creator, all peoples. Come, let us lift our voices in prayer and praise. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But when we confess our sin, God, who is faithful, forgives us and transforms our hearts. Trusting that God receives us with grace, let us confess our sin and the sin of this world, praying together. God, just as you called the disciples of old, so you call each one of us to be your witnesses in our world today. Forgive us when we are hesitant to follow, when we question your call or make excuses for our abilities, when we complain about our lack of time or hoard our resources. Give us courage to step out in faith, to go where you send us, trusting that your presence goes with us and that you will provide all that we need. Amen. Siblings in Christ, hear the good news. The mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. Indeed, God's steadfast love never ends. Know that you are forgiven and be at peace. And let all God's people say, Amen.
Oh.
The gospel lesson for the sixth Sunday after Pentecost is Mark chapter 16, verses 1 through 13. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Jesus left that place and came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. On the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, "Where did this man get all this? What is this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary and brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. Then Jesus said to them, "Prophets are not without honor except in their hometown and among their own kin and in their own house." And he could do no deed of power there except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief. Then he went about among the villages teaching. He called the 12 and began to send them out two by two, and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He ordered them to take nothing for their journey except a staff. No bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not to put on two tunics. He said to them, "Wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave the place. If any place will not welcome you and they refuse to hear you, as you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them." So they went out and proclaimed that all should repent. They cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I do not travel lightly. Now, don't get me wrong, I don't think I overpack. I've never been the person at the check-in counter scrambling to reorganize my bags in a last-ditch effort to get my checked luggage below 50 pounds. On group trips, I'm not usually the one with the largest suitcase, but I do like to be prepared. I blame my father. He's an Eagle Scout who follows the Boy Scout motto to a T, be prepared. So whether camping in a national park or staying in a New York City high-rise, my dad brings along his pocket knife and his first aid kit, just in case. It seems the apple does not fall far from the tree. When packing for a trip, I usually throw in a few extra outfits because you never know what you might spill on yourself. And I always bring enough sunscreen to cover an army in case, I don't know, Walgreens is out of stock. And I never leave home without my rain jacket and some light layers, even when the weather app forecasts 80 degrees and sunny all week long. I like to be prepared. Which means I usually return from a trip with a whole pile of stuff I never took out of the bag. And my husband just rolls his eyes and says sarcastically, "I'm so glad we brought that with us." Better to be safe than sorry, I say. According to the Gospel of Mark, Jesus has a different approach. "Take nothing with you," he tells his disciples. "No bread, no bag, no money, not even an extra shirt. Travel lightly," he says. In this passage, which is commonly referred to as the mission of the 12, Jesus sends his disciples out into the Galilean countryside with nothing but a staff. They have no bread to eat, no money to pay for food or lodging. They cannot provide for themselves. Instead, they must rely on the hospitality of strangers. It is interesting that Jesus sends his followers forth with such surprising instructions, particularly at this moment in their shared ministry. The 12 have been with Jesus since chapter 3, when he called them to proclaim the message and to have authority to cast out demons. Since then, the disciples have heard Jesus reveal the mysteries of the kingdom of God. They have watched in wonder as he calmed the storm and cast out unclean spirits. They have witnessed power flowing through him, enough to cure a hemorrhaging woman, enough to restore a young girl to life. And no doubt they have noticed the reactions of the crowds. Everywhere Jesus goes, people are overcome with amazement. Everywhere, that is, except Nazareth. Here at the beginning of chapter 6, Jesus returns home. And he does the very thing he's done in towns across Galilee. He walks into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and begins to teach. Only now the congregation is not made up of strangers. It's filled with people who've known Jesus since his parents brought him back from Bethlehem. The baker who'd sold him loaves of bread whenever Mary sent him to the market. The boys, now men, who'd played games with Jesus in the street. The family with the curious little girl, the one who'd peppered Jesus with questions the day he came round to fix their broken table. These people are not overcome with amazement. Rather, this hometown crowd takes offense. They rebuff Jesus. They reject his teachings. Their response is so strong that it momentarily diminishes his extraordinary gifts. Jesus could do no deed of power there except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them, Mark tells us. Now Jesus is the one who is amazed. He is amazed at their unbelief. But his experience in Nazareth does not derail his mission. Quite the opposite, in fact. Jesus responds to this rejection by sending out the 12, sending them to towns that might receive the apostles with open arms, to communities that might receive the gospel with open hearts. Take nothing with you, Jesus tells them. No bread, no bag, no money, not even an extra shirt. When you are invited into a house, stay there until you leave the town. If a place does not welcome you or listen to you, move on and shake the dust off your feet. Ever the teacher, it seems Jesus is using Nazareth as a teaching moment, an opportunity to instill in his disciples a sense of resilience, of hope. With the exception of the early recruits, Peter and Andrew and James and John, the disciples have not seen Jesus encounter such rebuke. Thus far, they've mostly been witnesses to wonder. The 12 have had front row seats as Jesus helped and healed, and as the newly restored responded with gratitude and praise. But as the Gospels make clear, the mission the apostles have accepted will bring its challenges. Like Jesus, they will experience rejection. And like Jesus, they will need to remain steadfast to God's purpose. So having endured hostility in the very place one would expect to receive hospitality, Jesus sends his disciples out with surprising instructions. Take nothing with you. They cannot pack provisions. They cannot even pretend to be prepared. The disciples have one option: rely on the hospitality of strangers. They must trust they'll find welcome in some household in some town. They must knock on doors hoping they'll encounter grace. Given the experience Jesus just had in Nazareth, his instructions to the 12 might seem overly optimistic, foolish even. But I expect they are rooted in a deep and profound truth. God's grace is sufficient. It's as if Jesus is telling his disciples, no matter where your journey leads, no matter what challenges you face along the way, God's grace is sufficient. Even when eyes fail to see and ears refuse to hear, God's grace is sufficient for this moment, for this mission. Of course, this is not a new lesson. As people who've grown up hearing the stories of the faith, the disciples know how God works. They know how God fed their ancestors with manna from heaven, raining down just enough each morning to satisfy them for the day. And they've heard how God commanded the ravens to bring bread and meat to the prophet Elijah to sustain him during his days in the desert. Yes, the disciples know how God works. And now, Jesus is sending them out empty-handed, no bread, no bag, no money, to discover for themselves how God works. They are to carry nothing save the assurance that grace will sustain them wherever they go. Mark tells us very little about the mission of the 12. At the end of this passage, the gospel writer simply reports, they cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. A little later, we witness their reunion. The apostles gather around Jesus to tell them all they had done and taught. Then Jesus invites them to come away and rest a while. It would seem the mission was a success. The disciples return likely exhausted but surely encouraged, bearing stories of lives transformed. We know the 12 were able to proclaim the gospel in word and deed, but we have to imagine for ourselves the details of their journeys. How many doors did the apostles knock on before one opened in welcome? Which households received them with open arms and open hearts? What stories did they share around the tables where disciples accepted their daily bread, not as manna from heaven, but as a meal shared among strangers turned friends? Yes, we are left to imagine the circles of care that formed around the 12 as they traveled from town to town. We are left to imagine the communities created as strangers welcomed Christ's servants, and in embracing both messengers and message, became partners in Christ's service as well. But this we know. God's grace was sufficient. Through hands extended in welcome, through stories shared at table, through hearts open to receive the good news, God's grace carried the disciples on their journeys. This is not a new lesson. It was not new for the 12 who'd grown up hearing the stories of the faith. It's not a new lesson for us either. We know how God works. It's just that sometimes we need a reminder. We need some new assurance that grace will carry us wherever we go. I remember a moment on my own journey when that assurance came to my door. I was 22 years old and eager to begin my year of service as a young adult volunteer. I just arrived in India and I was ready. I'd been ready. I'd raised the funds required of all volunteers to help subsidize the expense of the program. I'd read all the books our site coordinator had recommended, from essays about the legacy of colonialism to novels set in the Indian state I'd called home. I'd packed everything on the list and more. I was ready, but I was not prepared. Looking back, I'm not sure anything could have prepared me for the journey ahead, not even the assurance that God's grace would carry me through. No, I needed to discover this grace for myself. Upon arriving in India, my fellow volunteers and I had 2 weeks to get acclimated, to recover from jet lag, to learn a few key phrases in the local language, to practice the art of eating curry and rice with our hands. And then our site coordinator sent us out. Early on a Monday morning, he deposited us in the communities where we would live and work for the better part of a year. That first night was a difficult one. I stood in my simple apartment, staring at my packed suitcase and empty shelves, thinking, what am I doing here? I was all alone in a very foreign land with 11 months to go. And as I sat on my bare mattress on the verge of tears, there was a knock on the door. Are you coming to choir practice? Asked John and Rachel, an elderly couple I'd met at church the day before. Come on, they said. We'll drive you. Turns out I didn't have to knock on doors hoping I'd encounter grace. Grace found me. Through hands extended in welcome, through words of invitation, through the embrace of community. And on that night, and in the months to come, God's grace was sufficient. How many of us have discovered the same? Perhaps at a kitchen table in the highlands of Guatemala, while sharing homemade tamales and unlikely camaraderie with our sisters from the Association of Mom Christian Women. Or in gathering with neighbors from Friendship House, where circles of care are created as strangers become friends. Or in the living room of another from this family of faith, within relationships knit together here, where we break bread and share the cup and celebrate our communion in Christ. Through moments too many and too ordinary to notice, by countless hands extended in welcome, we find assurance again and again, God's grace is sufficient. God's grace will always be sufficient. And this grace will carry us wherever we go.
Let us join together in prayer. Loving and gracious God, we come before you this morning, as we so often do, with much, a upon our hearts and minds. We find ourselves seeking peace and your presence as we work to understand your word and your call to each of us. We thank you for this time together and ask that you would help us to slow down and to focus our thoughts and feelings so that we might live with purpose, commitment, and love. As we do so, we are grateful for the gift of your Son, Jesus, who evidenced in countless ways how we can live our lives in the light and inspiration of his. We acknowledge, as is evidenced from today's scripture reading and sermon, that our way forward is not always easy. There can be challenges of many different types as we endeavor to follow your word. And yet, there is so much that provides us with inspiration and hope. Our community of faith, our friends and family, our knowledge of your presence, your steadfastness, your compassion, and your grace. It is this which enables us to live as we otherwise would not find possible. And it is for this we are thankful, O God. We think this morning of our country on the anniversary of its founding and the values and principles upon which it is based. We are grateful for its high ideals and for its aspirations on behalf of justice and equality. At the same time, O God, we are aware that we have yet to succeed in making those ideals a reality across our land. Be with us as we continue the process of establishing fairness and justice for all. Help us to see that it is we, your people, who are called to further this effort and this calling in our time and in our place. And remind us, O God, as we commit to that holy task, that you will be with us and sustain us if we but dare to ask. Hear our prayers this morning, O God, those both spoken and unspoken, and grant us the assurance, the peace, and the inspiration only you can provide. This we ask with praise and with gratitude in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us how to live and taught us how to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Siblings in Christ, as you go forth as partners in Christ's service, go trusting that God's grace will carry you wherever you go. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, now and always. Amen.